All right, we concluded basically last week, my best friend, the Holy Spirit, but we really are continuing with the Holy Spirit and what we can do to have the Holy Spirit more powerful in our lives. And I would have to say that the most important thing, I grew up in a church, and maybe some of you did too. Some of you didn't, that's fine. But I grew up in a church that really believed that what we're really needing in the church today is the gifts of the Holy Spirit. We need more signs, more wonders, we need people to get healed and all that. And then I've been to other churches where I also grew up where I said, we need the fruit of the Spirit. And all those Pentecostal charismatics, all they want are the gifts. And all they want is the fruit. We need both today. In fact, let me say something really important. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are the what to get us to the why. And the why is the fruit of the Spirit. That's what we were looking for, is the fruit of the Spirit. The gifts of the Spirit help us to achieve the fruit of the Spirit. And that's the end game. You'll see in a few moments what I mean by that. And so maybe you grew up that way and you're wondering what's going on. And I have good news for you today, that God wants us to be fruitful. And he wants us to have fruit in our lives. And so we've been talking about that. And so today that's what we're going to be looking at and how that happens. I think some of the problems sometimes you and I have is that we just think that all we got to do is get information and we'll be set free. The Bible says you shall know the truth and the truth will set you free. Do you know what Jesus said? Jesus says, I am the truth. He didn't say, I'll show you the truth. He says, I am the truth. And so many times many of us will graduate college or we'll graduate high school. And what happens? You get a degree. I got a degree, I graduated from Harvard University or Yale University, wherever you go, or Tunksis Community College, wherever you've graduated from. And so I graduated, and I have it now, and now I can go on with this. And what would happen in that is that your degree would represent the 4 years or 8 years, or however long it takes you, to get through college. It represents all the coursework that you did and all the things that you learned. And you took tests, you passed tests, and as a result, all your professors and all of that, they give you a diploma, and you're on your way. Many of us treat God the same way. I read the Bible. I got prayed for with the baptism. I do this. I do the other. And so now I got the degree. Okay, I'm going to do this now. I'm going to live the Christian life, and we move on. That's all we have to do. But really, if you think about it, imagine you graduated college, and imagine that when you go up to shake the president's hand, they give you the diploma. They give you a diploma saying, okay, here's your diploma, and by the way, all the things that you learn are going to follow behind you. So now you have your professors behind you, you have your golf instructor, you have your whatever, you have your all these different professors with PhDs are following you behind. So now wherever you go, you have this big line of people following you to remind you of what you learned in school. How would you like that? You'd have to buy a bus, okay? No, we don't want that, of course. But in the kingdom of heaven, do you realize this? The problem you and I get into is we think we know it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. I'm saved. I got this thing. I know what to do. I got to stop doing this, stop doing this, stop doing this, try hard on this, do this and the other. I got to do this, this, and the other. And you have a checklist. I got to read my Bible. I got to come to church. I got to give. I have to tithe. Oh, I can't have fun. I can't go to the club. I can't do this. I can't drink. I can't smoke. I can't chew. I can't hang out with people that do. And you have all these lists of things to do, and it's exhausting. And you walk around with this kind of diploma of heaven. But the truth of the matter is, God never asked us to walk it alone. Do you realize when you give your life to Christ, Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes inside of you, and when you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, he's empowered it inside of you. Jesus says the Spirit will show you all truth, remind you of all things. So it's almost like graduating high school or college or your PhD program, and now all the professors, all the lessons you've learned is traveling with you in one person. So no matter where you go, you will be reminded and instructed and empowered. That's what Jesus promises the Holy Spirit will do. I don't know about you, but that's good news, right? So the problem is we often try to do. And when you try to do, it becomes do-do. You don't want to do that. You want to have a relationship that's ongoing with Christ. Let me show you what we're talking about here today. Galatians 5:16-21 tells us to do something. It says this. It says, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. We finished last week with this particular verse. Walk in the Spirit. Remember, it doesn't say get the information of the Spirit. It says walk in the Spirit. What did we say last week? Remember we talked, by the way, you should go back and listen to it. It's a very important message because we talked about what spirit are you of? And how one moment you can walk with God and do things great, the next moment you turn into a fiend. It can happen like this. And we showed that last week, and we said this. How do you choose what spirit you're of? We said, you are the spirit you are of with the one you're walking with. And so the Bible says, walk in the Spirit. Now, you've graduated, you know what's going on. The Holy Spirit walks with you. Walk in the Spirit. It doesn't say walk knowing about the Spirit. Quoting the Scripture, says, no, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the lust of the flesh is against the Spirit, and the Spirit is against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. Okay, how many can reply and understand what I'm talking about? How many of you do everything that you wish you could do? Anyone here this morning? There's absolutely nobody here this morning that does everything that they wish to do. That means this message, oh, there's one person. Okay, there's two people. God bless you. Three, all right. Man, we got some perfect people here this morning. All right, let's move forward. Now the works of the flesh are evident. What are they? Which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambition, dissensions, heresies, envy, murder, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I told you in the times past, and this is not a very kind thing to read, but it's the truth, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. What does that mean? Does it mean I'm going straight to hell? It says those who practice. Now, if you're struggling with various things and you're trying to get over drinking too much, or you're trying to get rid of a substance, maybe you're trying to get rid of worry, you're trying to get rid of a spirit of whatever, lust, whatever you're struggling with, and you're struggling with it, and when you make a mistake and you slip and you make the wrong, oh man, God, I'm so sorry. There's something that pulls you back. You're not happy in that sin. Chances are the Holy Spirit's still working in you. But if you don't even care anymore, I don't care, whatever, then you're not in a good shape. You need to say, hey, listen, I need to wake up here. The Bible says those who practice. Well, practice is something you do over and over again and resign. I don't care. I'm going to do it anyhow. Okay, you see the difference? Okay, so the works of the flesh. Well, how do we overcome? We got to walk in the Spirit. Well, how do you walk in the Spirit? You walk in the Spirit by developing the fruit of the Spirit, which we'll talk about in a few moments. But what's the fruit of the Spirit? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, my favorite one of the whole list. I love this one. Long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Now, this is really fun here. Look at this. Against such, there is no law. What is that supposed to mean? Well, how many of you try to do the right thing? I want to do the right thing. I get to do the right thing. Oh, I made a mistake again. The Bible says that if you and I will develop this fruit, you'll live above the law. You won't worry about breaking the law because you're not going to have to worry about it because you're living in the fruit of the Spirit. Now, there's something else I really, 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 really appreciate about this. It's botanical. It's about fruit. And I'm so glad that the Bible uses fruit. And we don't live in an agricultural society, but some of you like to plant things in your backyard, like plants and stuff and fruits and all that. And my wife tried to do it, and I mowed it over. We have cilantro, and I just weed-whacked it the other day. I said, man, that's great. Those weeds really smell good. That was a cilantro. You know, whatever. But anyhow, some of us do that. We whack God's work in us. But, you know, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering. And what's good about it is this. When you plant seeds, when I was a little kid, I got some apple seeds from an apple, and I put them in the ground, and I went down there every day looking at it. Where's the apple tree? Where's the apple tree? I have news for you today. You may not experience change overnight. And God understands that. That's why he calls it the fruit of the Spirit partially. Let me give you an example. I had an opportunity to work at Teen Challenge in Bedford-Stuyvesant in Brooklyn, New York, back in 1993. Did an internship there, seeing people get off opiates like heroin. What a horrible, horrible thing. And back in 1993, the heroin was weaker than it is now. It's a big problem. $25, you get a bag. It's crazy what's going on today. But anyhow, there was a men's director there named Abraham, and he was in charge of the men. They had a women's director, too. And I was talking to him over meals and saying, how you doing, Abraham? And what happened? What's your story? He says, well, I was on heroin for over 10 years. He said, it was awful. I stole from my parents. I robbed stores. Whatever I had to do, I had to get my fix. Because if I didn't get my fix, I would go through convulsions, and you feel like you're going to die. He says, it's absolutely horrible. It just got to the point I just tried to take it so I wouldn't have the withdrawal. He gave his life to Christ. He came forward. a pastor prayed for him. He sensed the power of the Holy Spirit come upon him. And all of a sudden, bam, completely delivered of heroin. No withdrawal, nothing. Zero, nothing. He was completely set free. But he said, but you know what I struggled with for 10 years or 6 years, he said? It's lust. He struggled with lust. Now, a lot of us would like, we want immediate joy, immediate love, immediate peace, long-suffering. Generally speaking, we have to develop these fruits. And Abraham showed me that, yes, God delivered him, and we should always seek deliverance right away. But sometimes God delivers us step by step, day by day. You keep walking in the same way. I remember seeing a picture of an oak tree that cracked a tombstone in half. An acorn got down and started to grow over the years. And after a period of time, that acorn turned to an oak tree, and it cracked the stone it was around. Listen, if you stay faithful in what God has given you, do not despise the days of small beginnings. Do not make light of what God is doing in your life. Be patient with yourself. Cut yourself some slack and stop the self-attack. You need to look at your neighbor and say, let me say that again. That's pretty good. I don't know where I got that from. Stop whatever I just said. Stop the self-attack and cut yourself some slack, okay? Yeah, that sounds like that's a T-shirt if I never saw one. So cut yourself some slack and stop the attack on yourself. God's not out to beat you up. He's out to grow you up, okay? And now all of this, by the way, the fruit of the Spirit, you know what the fruit of the enemy is? Hate, miserable, anguish. I want it right now. Meanness, goodness turns to badness. Faithfulness means you can't count on it. It's like going to DMV. Gentleness, roughness, do whatever the heck you want to. And that's the enemy's thing, and that will destroy you. But God wants to give us this fruit. Now, how do you do the fruit? Well, great. Now there's 9 fruits of the Spirit. One more thing on my check. I got to read my Bible, got to go to church, got to go to Grove Track, got to get involved with a small group, got to do this, got to do the other, I got to hit the treadmill, got to do no mill, whatever. I got to do all these things. Another thing on my list, just what I wanted. I'm so glad I came to church today. I don't know about you, but I'm sick of trying to do all these things. How about you? Because you can't do it. What's the answer? What's the answer to all this? How do we develop love, joy, peace, patience? Well, this is the next verse. And those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with his passions and its desires. It's to crucify it. And the Bible talks about crucifying. How do we do that? We crucify the flesh. Well, how do you crucify the flesh? We'll talk about it in a few moments. So, the fruit of the Spirit is the goal of our life and loving God and other people. Really, think about it. If you really boil it down, the fruit of the Spirit is the goal of our life. How many of you do not want to have love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control? You have all that. You're living above the law. You don't have to worry about doing the right thing because you're doing the right thing. And you live in freedom and joy and peace and love. Who doesn't want that, right? I want that. So do you. So the fruit of the Spirit is the goal of our life and loving God and other people. But there's a little issue here. How do we live in the fruit of the Spirit? How do we live in the fruit of the Spirit? Well, I'm going to give you 4 steps in a poem, and we're going to go home. No, that's not what's going to happen. No 4 steps in a poem. How do we live in the fruit of the Spirit? Well, here's the good news. You're going to like this one. You and I can't live in the fruit of the Spirit. Isn't that good news? So you're off the hook now. You can't do it. Isn't that great news? Okay, guys, the first service was a lot more responsive. We have to receive the fruit of the Spirit from God. If you're trying to produce love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, faithfulness, kindness, so if you try to produce it yourself, how frustrating would it be? Imagine me saying, I want you to go in your backyard and I want you to produce apple trees, fruit trees, tomatoes. You're going to do it. Well, how? I don't know. Make it happen. Read the Bible more. Pray more. Go to church. How ridiculous would that be? Okay, well, let me say something. That's how ridiculous it is to live the Christian life without walking with God through it. It does not work. This one, you have lemon-sucking religious people. The cannot-dos. And you get so frustrated, you throw caution to the wind. How do we do it? We have to receive the fruit of the Spirit from God. Well, how do you do that? How do you receive this, the fruit of the Spirit? So you also must consider yourself dead and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Realize you can't do it. You need God in Christ Jesus. So how do you receive the fruit? Well, I'm glad you asked that question. Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now being made perfect in the flesh? Again, we're just showing you and reminding us this morning that you didn't save yourself, did you? No, Jesus died on the cross to save you if you're a believer. You can't save yourself, and you can't keep saving yourself. So what you did in the Spirit, you must continue in the Spirit and not the flesh. So the Bible says, are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now being made perfect by the flesh? You can't. Well, how do you do it then? Well, there's three major influences upon our souls and our spirits. We mentioned it last week. I'll do it again. You got the flesh, right? You're hungry, you're tired, whatever it is. You got the Spirit of God in you, if you're a believer, and you have the enemy. Let's go ahead and just kind of review again, for as we did last week. We talked about the human spirit, a triune being. We got the body, we got the soul, we got the spirit. And the parts of the soul is the mind, the will, and the emotions. And make no mistake, the mind is the gateway to your will and your emotions. So it makes a difference what you think about. Okay? And so it gets there. What happened was the human spirit was broken because of sin. There's a vacuum here. And so when there's a vacuum, it sucks everything in. It tries to find a way to fill the brokenness in this life. And you can fill it by going to church, by the way, by doing a bunch of rules and coming all the time and quoting scripture and going to VBS and running VBS and going to Africa, India. You can try to make all these religious things or try it through drinking or drugs or promiscuity, whatever it could be, but it doesn't work. It's broken, right? It's broken fellowship with God. What happens? You gave your life to Christ. Boom. Now, your spirit has been restored, and now the Holy Spirit lives in you. And then we talked about being baptized in the Holy Spirit. What happens then is that you are you're installed extra power and ability where the Holy Spirit has more opportunity to flow in your life. Now you have fellowship and connection to God. Jesus says something very, very important. He said, out of your innermost being will flow rivers of living water. So what is the answer? The answer is God in you, the hope of glory. So what we need to do is realize we can't produce the fruit. We have to receive the fruit, and then we need to mine the fruit. Like a farmer, you plant seeds in the ground, watermelon, whatever you do. What do you have to do? The deer come, the possums come, the mice come. The neighbors come, whatever, okay? You got to set up little fences, don't you? You have to put fences there to protect you put pesticides and all that. You got to protect the fruit lest it be stolen away. And so you have to prepare them. You have to water it. So you have your part. You can't produce the seed, but you sure can cultivate the seed. So you can't produce love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, faithfulness, and kindness, but what you can do is cultivate the seed that God has given you, all right? Now, you cannot live in the fruit of the Spirit. We have to receive the fruit of the Spirit, and we partner with the Holy Spirit in us to live in the fruit of the Spirit. In other words, God gives you. With every vision, God gives the provision. You might want to write that one down. If you're not writing things down, write it down or text it in there. With every vision comes God's provision. God will never ask you to do something unless he'll give you the provision. He just won't. Well, how am I supposed to live in the fruit of the Spirit? Receive what God has for you. Listen, what we're doing here is we're letting the Holy Spirit be the well and be the power and the grace to give us the power to see in our emotions and our minds the fruit of the Spirit begin to happen. Bible says this, I love us, for we are his workmanship. You didn't make yourself, God made you. And this is why every life is precious to us. And we defend life from conception. We believe it's wrong to destroy life. So we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand. It wasn't even in your idea to be alive. It was God's. The desire for you to come to church isn't your desire. It's God put it in you beforehand that we should walk in. In other words, God gives you the seed. God gives the provision for the vision of his will in your life. Now, all we have to do is cultivate what he's given us and encourage what he's given us. That's the answer to our lives. And it happens through relationship. It doesn't happen with coming to church on Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday. It's walking with the Holy Spirit all the time. Remember, you got your degree. Now your degree is following you with all the things that you learn. The Holy Spirit wants to walk with you and help you develop these things. Colossians 3, 12 and 13. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, you also must do the same. So we have to put on something. We put on the garments that God has given us. We put on what God has given us. That's the whole process. Well, let me explain what this means, okay? And what happens is we need to cultivate the Holy Spirit within us. We have to stir up the gifts within you. The Bible, Paul says to Timothy, stir up the gift that was given to you in the laying on of hands. That's why we believe it's important to be filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's in you, but you need the baptism in the Holy Spirit, not just so you can walk around and lay hands on the sick and tumble around and speak in tongues. That's not what it's all about, by the way. Oh, that's fine. You know what it's about? It's about developing fruit. So we need the Holy Spirit. What the Holy Spirit will do is we cultivate. Holy Spirit, I need more love in my life. And the Holy Spirit says, I say to God, I don't have what it takes, God, to deal with the situation where this person is driving me to the point. I mean, imagine this for a moment. Imagine you go to motor vehicles, okay? You get to the front desk after waiting 2.5 hours, and the air conditioning broke down, so it's real hot in there. And so you go to the front desk, and what always happens? The lady or the guy says, I'm sorry, but we need an extra piece of paper, so you're going to have to go home. Now, let me tell you, the old Eric, the Italian Eric, I'd want to tell her off, right? But now the Holy Spirit says, okay, Holy Spirit, I'm agitated. Okay, Holy Spirit, I pray you give me grace and peace. Well, thank you, ma'am, for doing your job. I really, really appreciate it. Okay, so I go home, right? And then I come back. Well, you know, that's what can happen. You can get, but what you do, you say, God, I thank you that you give me the provision to have patience. Not in my power, but your power, God. I ask for patience to come, Lord. I ask for patience to come. So we go back to this list. Love. The absolutely most important thing in the fruit of the Spirit is there in order. Even in the Greek, it's love. You know what the word love in the Greek is? It's agape. You know what agape means? Not sloppy agape, for those of you who like to use that. Agape is self-sacrificing love. It's love without strings attached. It means I'm going to love you regardless of what you do to me. Your response back to me has no bearing on the love I'm going to show you. While we were still sinners, Christ agaped us. Now, imagine that for a moment. If you and I love somebody and we expect something in return, what's going to happen invariably? We're either going to be satisfied with a response or dissatisfied and upset, right? So now, who becomes the gauge of how you respond? The person. So guess what begins to happen when you live your life that way? People and circumstances will puppeteer your emotions. I don't know about you, but I don't want anyone else controlling me. When you love and expect nothing in return, I can't get disappointed. So if you're getting offended by people, the problem is you're expecting something from people that only God can give you. A spirit of offense. And yes, we need to have the right thing. But so love, agape love. And so what would happen if your spouse, who you call a louse, you go home and they're on the couch, and the kids are running around, and there's bloody murder going on, and they're like, hey, honey, how you doing? And they're sitting there looking at Sports Center, right? Well, what's going to happen? What are you going to do? Okay, Lord, thank you that I have the patience to beat my husband silly. No, I'm kidding. But, no, you say, Lord, I'm going to come with love right now. I'm going to have joy, and I'm going to have peace, and I'm going to explain to him what I'm going through. Maybe you had a hard day at work, and you just go relax, and I'm going to, why let a circumstance, you're going to come into a house that's chaotic, and all of a sudden, you're going to let those circumstances push all your buttons, and you're going to be a wreck. Is that worth it? How about this? I'm going to go into that chaotic situation. Now, am I suggesting husbands lay on the couch and do nothing, watch television? No, I'm not suggesting that. It is nice once in a while. But I'm not suggesting that. I'm not making excuses that just sit there and be steamrolled by circumstances or husbands or wives. But what I'm trying to say is, why are you going to let people control you? Why are you going to let circumstances control you? We can have the fruit of the Spirit control you. I'm going to walk in love. And love is, we're a family. We work together. This is not right. Let's work this out. And tell them and treat them like a human being and not like a little child. You can still deal with change, but you do it in love. You do it in joy. I'm so happy that the house is going to get better because these sets of circumstances, they're not going to continue anymore because I got a frying pan in my hand. No, that's not the reason why. But you got joy. And what's joy? Joy is something that's beyond circumstances. You see, joy, for the joy set, is one of the most important verses in the Bible. It really is, in Hebrews. For the joy set before him, Christ endured the cross. Didn't say, because his disciples were cool people and he's going to have a last supper with them, he endured the cross. No, it says, for the joy set before him. What was that? What he was going to do is be with God back forever and ever and ever again. Do you realize this? That Jesus worked and had the Holy Spirit in him as well. Everything Jesus did, he by the power and person of the Holy Spirit. He never walked alone. He never got his degree from heaven. Oh, I got a degree from heaven. I'm God. Okay, cut off. I'm on my own now. You realize everything Jesus did, he walked with the Holy Spirit, listened to the Father, everything he did. There's only one time where Jesus did not was not walking with God. You know when that was? He was on the cross. He said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He could not exist without it. Yet we're like, you know, that's Jesus. I can do better than Jesus. Truth is, we're not called to walk it alone. We're called to walk it with the Spirit, to have the Holy Spirit, to cultivate the whole God. The situation at work right now, I'm at motor vehicle. I need long suffering. Okay, so that's all what we part to do here. And it's very interesting as you look at this. Goodness, we have joy, we have peace, we have long suffering, we have kindness. Being kind to somebody. Imagine you're going to West Farms Mall. It's Christmas Eve, and you have to buy your mother-in-law, a gift, and there's no parking space. You've been driving around like a vulture on a roadkill trying to find a way to go in, and all of a sudden, this person pulls up that wasn't even there, and he goes like that. What do? You go, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Is that what you do? All of a sudden you go, you know, and all of a sudden you have a choice. Am I going to be angry and frustrated and get my blood pressure up? I have to go see a doctor now, come home, and how's your day? Terrible. And you ruin the whole Christmas? Or I'm going to say, Holy Spirit, I'm jacked. I'm upset. Holy Spirit, I need some love. I need some joy. And I need some peace. Thank you, Father. You give me the provision to deal with the circumstances. And you make a choice. And by the way, I've done this. It actually works. I stopped my road rage, okay? I'm just kidding. Seriously, there have been times where all of a sudden I get, what? No, I go like this. You know what I do instead? I go like this. I smile and I wave. It drives them crazy. That, you make people angrier going like this than doing the other thing. You're like, go ahead. No, you go ahead. No, you go ahead. No, you go ahead. No, you go ahead. That happened to me one day. I was doing that at the corner. I'm not making this up. I'm like, you go, and he got so upset he did something else. Anyhow, but I think I saw the person in church today. Okay, Joe. I'm just kidding. I love Joe Bain so much that he can sit down. He does our sound, does an amazing job. And now he's sitting just hanging out today. So it's good to see you, Joe. So we have love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness. How about faithfulness? I mean, who doesn't want to have an employee that shows up on time? You have a sales presentation due on Friday, and they have it done on Wednesday. They show up early and they stay late. That's called faithfulness, right? Gentleness, being gentle with some people. There's some people that are new believers and, oh, they're so legalistic. Relax. Be gentle with people. Be gentle with people that are new in the faith. Be gentle with people that are smaller than you or not as mature as you are. How about this one? Self-control. Oh, that's the good one, right? Self-control. Do you realize that the fruits of the Spirit give you something that you're always longing to do? Come on, let's be honest here this morning. The thing that frustrates all of us, but bottom line, is this. I don't do the thing I want to do. I want self-control. And if you try to muster enough strength, but what we need to do is ask the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I pray for more self-control. Now, I want to tell you not to do something. Don't ask God to give you patience. Buy the flowers instead. Don't buy the patient flower. Because you ask for patience, God will give you plenty of opportunity. There's people that I just thank God for, that they have just polished me so well. There's some people that just, you know, seriously, there's been times I'm like, oh, make me sick. And God, listen, no one makes you sick. It's your choice. You're right, God. Now grow up and get over it. And so I had to work my character. Unfortunately, my character doesn't seem to grow very well as things are going bad. All right, so this is all part of having the fruit of the Spirit in our lives. Now listen to this. This is Jesus. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Now what's one of the fruits of the Spirit? Love, joy, peace. Okay? Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Peace I leave with you. Let me ask you a question. Just track with me. Remember what happened. Jesus came from heaven to earth. He gave up all his deity and became a human being and functioned the same way you and I do. He had functioned on the Holy Spirit, with the Holy Spirit, and in relationship with the Father. All right? That's everything he did. And so Jesus, while he was on the earth, while in human form, he says, peace I give to you. Do you realize you can give peace to people? No, I'm not talking about that peace. I'm talking about peace. You can actually give peace to people. Ever meet somebody, you meet somebody, and you just feel better? It's like someone comes in a room, you're having a bad day. Hey, how you doing? Doing good. They talk to you, they encourage you, and amen, you walk out, you feel better. Have you ever had a great day and someone comes into like the pig pen from Peanuts? They have a cloud around them, and all the elections this year. Can you believe Hillary? Can you believe Trump? By the way, it's hard to be positive in this election cycle. But anyhow, so you look at all this, and they're complaining about that. I say, you know what? What we need to do? Why don't we pray for our country? Let's pray. Let's pray for our country, because you know we're all Americans here. And by the way, can you do me a favor, please? Don't be played a fool by our media. Don't get an us against them. Please, can we do that self-effect? Can we just pray for our government? Can we just pray for those that are running for office, both parties? Can we show people with dignity and respect? What would happen if we did that? Do not let yourself get into the game they're playing. They're playing the game out there. They just want to get elected. Both people want to get elected. And they'll throw negative ads. Let's not do that. Let's be positive. Let's be full of life, right? Speak the truth in love. And so peace, you can bring peace. Now, what happens if you're pulling up your driveway and it's raining cats and dogs? Well, let's say it's just raining dogs. And you open the garage door and there's like bicycles there. And you told your children all week, please move the bicycles out of the way. But every piece of hardware you have in your house is in the carport and it's raining and you had to get in there to go to a funeral and go out. Now, I can do two things right then. I can get really irritated and angry, or I can say, okay, Father, thank you for this opportunity to build my self-control. Thank you, Father, that I have a carport that I can pull into. Thank you, Father, that I have children that can make a mess of the garage, because one day I'll be crying because no one's at home. Now, I wish I could tell you that's how I handle circumstances. That's not the way it is most of the time, unfortunately, but I'm learning. It's hard, right? You know when it's hard? It's hard when you think it's up to you. It's not up to you. What it's up to you is to let the Holy Spirit come inside of you. Holy Spirit, I'm needing more patience right now, Father. I thank you. With the vision comes the provision. Amen. Be holy, for I am holy. And I thank you, Father, you understand that this is fruit, and fruit takes time to grow. So I have to take one step forward today. I only yell for 2 seconds instead of 10 seconds. I'm doing better. You know, let it go forward. Don't give up. Do not be discouraged. My peace I leave. And by the way, you can take the fruit of the Spirit and you can bring it to work with you. You can go to your house. I love what Jan Nell says. I really appreciate him, his teaching. He talked about this, how he would pull up to our house and speak peace in the place before you go to work. Say, the strife not, I speak peace in that place. Thank you, Father. I'm going to bring your peace in here. So when everyone's in the lunchroom or the break room and they're, you know, the boss walks by, they're friendly. Hey, how you doing? Good to see you. He walks away. What a jerk. Right? And then some person's in the break room with you and they're talking about somebody. They walk away. And then the person that walk away is they talk about a horrible person that was just in the room. And then you walk away and they talk about you. Right? What would happen? Yeah, he's under a lot of stress, but you know, I really appreciate the fact he worked so hard. Because he worked so hard, we could be here today. Try to follow you. Why are you so positive? Oh, because I want to be positive. It's, you know, and you know what? That brings life. The devil comes to bring hate.
right? Sadness, disturbingness, you know, just things of that nature. So we can move forward, abide. Look what Jesus says here. How do we do it? How do we do it? I'm so glad you asked the question. How do we do it? The Bible says, come to church on Sunday, read your Bible every day, and check the list. Get involved with a small group, go to Grove Track, and you'll be fine. That's what it says there, right? No, it doesn't say that. What does it say? Abide in me. Abide does not mean you go to Holiday Inn Express for a couple of nights. Abide means I bought a lot of land, and I'm building a house on this land, and it's going to be my dwelling. I'm going to raise my kids here. I'm going to get the dog, not the cat, but I'm going to get the dog and the cat. I'm going to build. I'm going to have my family here. I'm going to live here. I'm going to plant grass. This is my abode. I'm going to live here. This is my shelter. The Bible's saying, abide in Jesus. Do you see that? We're to abide in Jesus. Abide in me. This is Jesus speaking, by the way. And I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides. Again, we're not talking about I go to church on Sunday, I go to men's group, I go to women's group, I help the poor, I help Acts 4, I go to Teen Challenge, I help the old ladies cross the street, I do all these things. No, I'm not talking about that. It says, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit in itself, the reason why you're so frustrated is you're trying to bear the fruit by yourself. You're not called to bear it by yourself. With the vision comes the provision, and it comes from within, not from without. Cannot bear fruit of itself unless it what? Abides. Now, I notice this. Boy, what's the deal with the Jesus here? He keeps on saying, he says, abide, 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 abide. Well, you know what? In the Greek language, when they repeat a word several times, it basically is like yelling. It's like, listen up here, folks. Abide. Okay? Abide with me and I in you, as a branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He or she who abides in me and I in him bears what? Much fruit. Fruit of what? Fruit of the Spirit. Right? Isn't that great? But listen to this. For without me, you can do nothing. Here's the part I don't like. If I was a positive pastor and didn't want to talk about the other part, I wouldn't hear the next part of the verse. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they're burned. Well, thank you. I feel so much better now. Hang on. If you abide in me and my words abide. Words are hearing the word of God, abiding. The words become flesh and dwell among us. My words abide in you. You will ask what you desire. It's God's desire that you have love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, gentleness, and self-control. God wants you to have all that. That you don't have to worry about doing right and wrong because you're doing it right anyhow. Think about it. Imagine that. Imagine living a life where no more do circumstances control your emotions. No longer can someone make you sick anymore. No longer can the economy, no more can your boss or your children. No, you are above it. You don't let anything bother you anymore. Now you set the climate in the room. You set the spirit in the room. No one else sets it. I don't know about you, but that's a place where I want to live. We got to stop being victims of circumstances and be the change that we want to see. Let the Holy Spirit reside and move and grow in you. You speak in tongues, so what? You lay hands on the sick and they recover, so what? That's all good. But we do all those things so we can have the end result of the fruit. The gifts without the fruit is nothing. But I want the gifts, of course. The gifts help us to produce the fruit. So we want to see this in our lives. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such, there is no law. The devil can't touch you when you're living in this. You become a greasy pig. He can't touch you.
Forget MC Hammer. I'm dating myself. Can't touch this. And he goes to heaven and says, I'm so frustrated. Why? Well, he's got love. He's got joy. He's got, I can't touch him. Forget about calling down demon strongholds. I mean, there's a place for that. The biggest spiritual warfare that you and I can do, this is a nuclear arsenal that will completely blow up the enemy and drive him absolutely. You want to drive the enemy insane? Cultivate love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against, there's no law. He uses the law to kill, and he can't kill you anymore because you're living the fruit. With the provision, with the vision comes the provision. God has given us these things. Don't try to produce it yourself. Thank God ahead of time. I've created in Christ Jesus for good works. Good works is having the fruit. And let's move forward. The fruit of the Spirit is the goal of our life and loving God and other people. Listen, I want to encourage you today. We can do this, folks. The Bible says, abide in me and I in you. Do you know Jesus is the body and we are what? The members of the body. You're not called to do this by yourself, by the way. It's you and God alone. No, it's called the body of Christ. You need to get connected to other people that are going after the same thing. Other people that are growing their fruit gardens. Hang out with people that got fruit. You see someone doesn't have fruit and you're struggling with your fruit, don't hang out with people who don't have fruit. Okay? Hang out with people that are going somewhere in God. Find people that have fruit. Wow, look at their tomato plants. They got big tomato plants. I'm going to hang out with them. How do you grow your tomatoes? Well, I put a little fertilizer. Hey, and they can help you grow. You don't envy their garden. You ask them to help you with your garden. And you encourage each other. And you learn secrets. I hear people all the time, but Home Depot. Oh, my garden is. And people talk about their gardens. They're so excited. Oh, try this. My compost. And they get all excited about their garden. I couldn't care less about it. I just mow over it. But nevertheless, find people that are going after the same thing you're going after and encourage each other. Hey, listen, God wants us to live in the fruit of the Spirit. We can do it if we would work together. Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you so much that you did not leave us as orphans. And Father, I want to thank you again that you're not asking us to do this all by ourselves. You're not asking us to produce these things. You're asking us to cultivate what you've already put inside of us. Thank you for that, God. Thank you that I don't have to do. All I have to do is cultivate what you've done for us. And so, Lord, in Jesus, right now, I just pray for encouragement to come across this place right now. Everyone hearing my sound of my voice, whether they're here or watching later on or live, Father, we're thanking you that the fruit of the Spirit, we're asking that Cornerstone would be known as a church that has so much delicious fruit. Fruit that's ripe and to be picked in Jesus' name. We thank you for this opportunity today. With every head bowed, let me ask you a question. You can come to church. You can even be a pastor of a church. But have you actually given your life to Jesus? Are you still calling the shots? I believe in God. Yeah, but have you ever asked Jesus to be number one in your life? Have you ever said, God, no longer me, it's Christ in me? If you've never given your life totally to Christ, today can be your day. You cannot produce this by yourself. You need Jesus. To love Jesus, you need Jesus. To produce fruit, you need Jesus. And if you don't know for sure, if you were to die today, where you'd go, the Bible says you can know that you're saved for sure. So if you would like to give your life to Christ today, recommit or give your life to Christ, I'm going to ask you to pray this prayer with every head bowed. We're going to pray together. If you pray this prayer from your heart, it's not a magical word. It's your heart connecting to the truth of what you're declaring. Say, Lord Jesus, I thank you for dying on the cross for me. I believe you are the Son of God. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins. Forgive me. For I have sinned, I've done wrong, and I recognize I can't do enough good things for you to accept me. I thank you that you paid for all of my sins on the cross. I receive the forgiveness of everything I've ever done wrong, and I thank you that I can go to you every day and receive forgiveness. I give my life to you today. Have my life. I give my life to you today, and with your help, I will walk the path you have for me today. In Jesus' name, with every head bowed, can I just see a quick show of hands? Say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer today. Anyone say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer today? Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you, thank you. Anyone else? Okay, thank you. Put your eyes up if you could real quick. There's a card here. It's called a connection card. And on it, it says here, I've accepted Jesus today as my Savior for the first time, or I've recommitted my life. It's important to acknowledge this so you can get on the right path. I'm going to ask you to fill that out. And at the end of the service today, you can put one of those brown boxes or give it to one of the people in the prayer team. Make us all stand if we could. I'm going to ask the prayer team to make their way down. If you need prayer for anything at all, I want to pray for you right now. And I want to pray something on you. I want to pray a blessing on you this morning. I want to pray the fruit of the Spirit on you this morning, okay? Let's receive it. Let's lift our hands as an act of receiving right now. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your fruit. Father, I pray for love. I pray for joy. I pray for peace. I pray for long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control to be upon everyone here at Cornerstone. And we thank you that against such, there is no law. Father, we do not despise the days of small beginnings. We thank you that with the vision for godliness comes a provision. We thank you that all that we need is in you, Christ Jesus. We ask that we would cultivate your spirit to become the men, the women, and children you called us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. God bless you. We're going to have a closing song. When we do that, we want to ask you if you'd like to have prayer for any reason at all. We'd love to pray with you. Amen. Let's walk on that truth today. God bless you. If you'd like to have prayer, come forward. We'd love to pray with you. Go ahead and get your Kwasi tickets, and also we'll see you at Grove Track if you'd like to come. God bless you.